So we're getting a new look at the psychological warfare Ukraine is waging against Russia. The Washington Post recent piece says that Ukraine is scanning faces of dead Russians, then contacting the mothers, and it shows Ukrainian officials are using face scanning software from U.S. tech company Clear AI to help ID dead Russian soldiers, and then sending the photos of those corpses to their family members. I want to discuss now with John McLaughlin, the former acting director and former deputy director of the CIA, and Colonel Liam Collins, a former defense advisor to Ukraine. I'm so happy to have both of you on. This is a fascinating story. Good evening, John. We have discussed on this show before that the thing that most resonates most with Russians about this war is when their children don't return home. Will the Ukrainians using this facial ID on these dead Russian soldiers have the effect on those Russian families that they wanted to?
Well, you know, Don, I understand the emotional reasons for doing this, and it's certainly scientifically clever. But I have my doubts about how this plays in Russia. I think it'll play fine with some people who will take it if they are predisposed to not like this war, who will take it as evidence that it's a bad idea. But I think a lot of Russians will find this to be a little over the top in terms of a little macabre. And I think it could backfire on the Ukrainians in that sense, as much as I want them to win and support them and believe in their cause. But this might not be a great tactic.
Colonel Collins, Clearview's technology is able to identify many of these dead soldiers through their profiles on social media platforms like Instagram or Russia's VK. Is this a clear indication that the war isn't just a physical one, but a virtual one as well?
Yeah, that's correct. And really, they took a page out of the Russians' book. I mean, Russians did something, you know, similar types of things earlier in the conflict in the Donbas, where they targeted cell phones of Ukrainian members and spoofed family members, sending them texts about their son being killed, which didn't happen. So this is a case where the Ukrainians have actually learned from the Russians and are leveraging that 21st century technology.
Do you think it's a good or bad idea? John says it may not go over so well with some.
Yeah, I mean, I think, right, you got the legal moral aspect to it. And then, you know, is it a prudent decision? Will it accomplish what you're trying to do? And I think I kind of tend towards John. I think the jury's still out on this one, but it has the potential to backfire, just like indiscriminate bombing does, where it often, instead of, you know, bombing the population to submission, actually galvanizes the population to be more committed to their cause. So I think it's too early to tell. But, you know, as a former soldier, I really wouldn't want my family members being targeted. So I can see how this would have a chance of backfiring.
What about retaliation?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know what Russia will do to retaliate in this case. I mean, it's, you know, Russia is going to, you know, do indiscriminate bombing as they've done throughout the conflict. And as we saw, you know, hitting targets in Lviv today. So I don't really see Russia retaliating in any specific way, because they don't really seem to be beholden to, to strike just military targets.
John, you agree with
that?
But,
you know, Don, I think your earlier point is the main one here, that regardless of how this plays in Russia, it is very strong evidence that this is a social media war. This is the first war that I recall in which social media of all sorts has played such a powerful role. It's empowered people who otherwise would not have a lot of power. It's, they're online. You can look up conversations among Russian soldiers who are talking on open lines. You can find that on YouTube. This is unlike any other war in that respect. And the facial recognition technology is not a new thing for the Ukrainians. Working with the United States, they did essentially this in Crimea when the Russians took it over. Remember the little green men? They used this kind of technology to identify them as Russian military when the Russians were saying, nah, they're just loyal locals, you know.
Yeah. Well, I mean, just technology in general. I mean, it's covering a war. I remember, you know, covered several wars in my career as a journalist. But to be able to get people live from bunkers, you know, in their homes as they're being bombed, it's fascinating to watch the technological advances when it comes to our coverage of an active war. John, according to the Post, digital rights group Privacy International has called on Clearview to stop its work with Ukraine due to concerns over misidentification. Is that a legitimate concern?
Well, it is a real concern. This technology is great, but it's not perfect, particularly on people who aren't alive. Some forms of it Americans are very familiar with. We use it on our iPhones. The iPhone measures about 300 points on your face in order to use Face ID with the iPhone. But in circumstances where you don't have a lot of control over what you're photographing, there are some issues about its accuracy, although the company claims it's 99% accurate. The other thing is we've seen use of this technology in identifying some of the January 6th insurrectionists in this country. And that too has provoked some calls from civil liberties groups about the appropriateness of that. To me, it seems fine, but this is something that's popping up a lot in what we call open source intelligence. That is to say, there are ethical issues that you don't normally encounter in some of these circumstances that arise from the fact that information is so easily available and so easily propagated without much governance of it. So it's going to be an issue.
You know, Colonel Collins, you know the Ukrainian forces well since you've worked with them. Are there other methods of non-traditional warfare that are using to combat this Russian invasion?
Yeah, I mean, I would say they're using every tool that they can think of. I mean, like John said, I mean, this the use of social media. I mean, Zelensky's been phenomenal with communicating to the West and trying to explain the need and why they need various support from the West. So I think you're seeing that, and other times we're not seeing how they're using technology with volunteers or just Ukrainian citizens identifying where Russian vehicles are located so that the Ukrainian forces can take them out. So I think there's probably more going on that we just haven't seen yet.
Colonel Collins, I've got to ask you about the U.S. security aid for Ukraine. There are a number of weapons included in this latest $800 million package, including helicopters, switchblade drones, howitzers, javelins. How quickly do you expect Ukrainians to be trained on this new weaponry?
Yeah, for most of them, it's things they already have, or it's very similar to weapon systems they already have, right? Like javelins, we started providing those in 2018. So most of the forces probably trained on that. The helicopters you see, the Mi-17s, those are Russian helicopters. That's the same kind of helicopter that they have. So there's no learning curve involved with that, right? Some of the vehicles, right, they're not complex tank systems. They're armored personnel carriers. And really moving troops from point A to point B, not as much fighting vehicles. So fairly low learning curve on that, and that's by design, right? We don't want to give them weapon systems that's going to take a long time to train on because we have to get them distributed. Probably the weapon system that requires the most time are that switchblade, the loitering munition, the munitions drones, and those take a couple days probably to train somebody. So that's probably the one that requires the most training time. But other, by and large, the weapon systems that we're giving them are things they already have or are extremely similar to ones they have, so very low learning curve to them.
All right. Colonel, John, thank you both, gentlemen. We'll have you back soon. Appreciate it.